let's get some of these words out. We got sensation. We have hue. What were the other ones you said, Amber?
Consolidation.
Consolidation. Sorry, Amber.
Saturation.
Thank you.
Saturation. Brightness. Anything? Okay, and the colors we came up with: purple, hot pink, red,
yellow.
Yellow. I forgot that one. Yeah.
Doesn't have to be visual, does it? Intensity.
Okay. What does it have to? What could it also be?
Just got to be
emotional.
Powerful.
Okay. It could be powerful and raw. And what would that look like? And not visually, but what would it feel like?
Well, it feels like a sort of sudden burst.
Blow.
So if I. Is that intense?
It's not a wave. It's not as burst.
It's a sustained
wave.
It's a. I don't think it's just. It's not just a one.
Okay,
it's
good.
It's a It's a kind of.
A wave. Wave.
Sustained.
Sustained motion.
Okay, so Fred, can you open the door and then slam it shut?
Pleasure.
Just make sure nobody's coming through it.
Okay.
Oops. I almost thought your finger would there. No, can you do it again, this time, without leaning on it as you do it? Wait. Not further back. Okay, now when you do this, and you push it, I want people to tell me how long is the intensity. Where did the intensity start?
I'm letting go.
Start to the very moment you was put in his force behind the door.
Okay, try it again.
Is intensity low enough? What's it?
Oh my god. Yeah, that's right.
Yeah.
Amrit, sorry.
This can be anything but intensity.
You don't think it's intense
no,
at all?
No, it is. From the moment he let it go.
Well, when
the intensity started when he just let it go and finished to the last second of that sound.
Okay, does anybody want to try walking through the door but stopping before Fred shuts it? Really? No one wants to try this? Okay, I'm going to try it. Okay, so what I want you to do is I want you to see if I can get through here. I want to see if I can get through there before he shuts the door. Okay.
Okay,
ready?
Now, I'm not
slamming.
Just pushing the door. You're slamming.
Okay. Okay, ready?
Yeah.
Okay, now we're going to try just slowly pushing the door. You ready?
Yeah.
Slowly pushing it. Okay, now, were each of those movements, which one was intense?
The first one. Yeah.
Which one?
The first one.
Why?
The energy, the climax.
Zero. From there, if you took the background noise of the room as a base, and then you had the volume of the noise, it would go like that. And that's it's sudden and it's large. So you have two measures of very non-zero things.
Good. Okay. But almost everyone agrees that the second one wasn't very intense, or wasn't intense at all.
I thought intensity was change.
Yes.
And,
okay.
And acceleration even more so.
Yes.
You know, if the change is changing.
Yeah.
And so I would say both were intense in the sense of the word we're using.
Okay.
Although the louder one, I forgot which one it was now.
The first one that
was more intense in the sort of normal use of the term.
Why?
Because it's louder.
No. Because it's more dangerous and more risky.
So the expectation was maybe I would get stuck in the door, or maybe I would like punch Fred for slamming the door in my face or something like that, right? There's a view that my coming through that door and the slamming of the door created a much higher peak, a much stronger shift than me sliding through the door. I realize it was a little bit slow, but that's the cold I have that's coming in. So if I had slid through the door and the door shut, if it wasn't so awkward the way I ended up doing it, you know, so I had to catch the door and kind of go through it, it kind of really slowed down the intensity problem. If that were the case, then they're both intense. It's just like Amber's saying, I mean, they're both having peaks, they're both playing with zero and ones and this kind of peak and trough, but one of them sustains it longer, and it's the one that's actually the shorter version of the thing. So the intensity feel lasts longer, even though the other one, I sort of slowly, it was a slower move. Do you understand that?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, now, let's go back now for Helen to read.
I have a question.
Okay.
How would you apply this to the artwork?
We're
going to
do that right now.
That one more intense. It's not the concept. It must
Wait,
be.
Say that again?
The one that's more intense, because you might get cut in half by the door.
Yes.
It's not the concept, presumably, that makes it more intense.
Right, what is it?
It's. I suppose it must be some kind of emotional.
Well,
the expectation.
It's a kind of a collaboration or a confrontation of various senses that
right.
come in. One of them is expectation, another is fear.
So
I hope you weren't
so
expecting me again.
No.
that's all.
Yeah, so we're talking about an affect, A-F-F-E-C-T. Yeah? Okay. Now.
I shouldn't play with doors because I lost half of my finger trapped in a door. So.
Did you?
Oh,
yes.
I mean, I actually remember you saying that.
Yeah. Don't worry, I'm over it.
That's right. Not really. Yeah.
My
what, how did that happen?
Wind slammed door on it and it just hung off by a thread of skin.
Oh,
you need to see the inside.
Okay, so that little story helped with the intensity question. <Yes. laughs> Thank you.
It was intense.
Yeah, I bet
well,
it was.
I was 5 years old, so it was pretty.
And so, not to like make you relive a tragedy, but when that happened, the intensity was. Did you realize the door was slamming in your finger and you couldn't move your hand, or did you just it just all happened at once?
It was all yeah
boom
at once.
Right. Okay.
So, yeah, it just happened. And, yeah.
It's very common. So,
yes, that's why I almost had a nervous breakdown when you were okay. Actually. And then I'll stop the stories. There was a time period, well, I will never stop the stories, but there was a time period when I was the director of a day camp. You know, gotta make a living. Actually, I loved it. And the children that went to the camp were all part of, it was in Washington, D.C., and their parents were all like spies, and they worked for the CIA and, you know, stuff like that. So it was like a completely mad thing. And I might have mentioned this before to you, but at one point it was very warm, and the counselors were they had fallen asleep because it was so hot, and they had a film, and this is the olden days when you had a film on a reel, and it went
mm-hmm.
like this,
mm-hmm.
and this was called Street Music, this film. Anyway, I remember this to this day because they fell asleep to that lovely hum to wake up to see these like 4 to 6 year olds staring at the film, which it turned out was a porn film that was done in some sort of it was this music, so the trees would turn into phalluses, and, you know,
yeah,
the bushes would be vaginas, and it was, like, fantastic, you know. And so, and anyway, so I then went in and I said, look, you know, this is all very interesting, I'm glad you're learning about this, you know. But if you have any questions, you know, you don't need to take it to your parents. You tell me, I'm totally able to do this. And one of the more precocious children in the class, this young girl who was, like, 5, decided to make money by drawing various forms of sexual intercourse that she had seen on with the plants and the trees and whatnot that were going on, and sell them in her neighborhood for 5 cents a sheet. And her mother, her mother was so upset, she came running in and threw this down, and, you know, it was like, you know, what have you done to my daughter? You know, she's like, you know, she's going to become a harlot, you know, and I'm looking at it and saying, well, you know, they're not bad, you know, for a 5-year-old, you have to admit, you know, well done, anyway. She got in her car and she was so mad, she shut the car door and slammed it on her leg. And then the whole scene changed, right? Because suddenly we had a leg that was still attached, which was the good news, but she was so flipped out. Luckily, I was a hero in that particular case. I felt like I had orchestrated this so that I would get off the hook of her lawsuit if they were going to sue us about this. Anyway, now, this little story I've told you, this little rhizomatic move that's gone on, it's reminded me of something. So what does that tell you What happened just then, apart from the fact that I just tried to entertain you with a mad story? What did this rhizome go to? What did it spawn to?
One intensity ended up overtaking another.
Okay, but what did I literally pull from my arsenal?
A leg.
Memory. So that's one of the things that kicks in the intensity game. I did this longer version of it, a sort of sustained version, but it's somehow the memory is going to kick into this. Okay. Helen, why don't we try reading that darn thing?
Intensities. Partly following Freud's description of the primary processes of the unconscious.
Pardon me, which are?
Sex and death.
Yes, but you might want to say it differently. What are the drives called?
You mean the eat?
Well, what are the drives?
Eros and Thanatos.
Yeah. Eros and Thanatos, death drive, pleasure principle.
That's right.
Okay. All right, go on.
Lyotard considers intensities as unbound excitations of force, which are characterized by their displaceability, their instantaneity, and their resistance to the temporal synthesis of memory.
So what does that synthesis, what is a temporal synthesis of memory? You're going to be very good at dinner parties here.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, go on. What is it?
This is the kind of the timely transferal of, so that we trigger the memory trigger. Maybe.
Good.
Yeah.
But not correct.
The memories.
But it was very good attempt. Yeah.
Good idea. I mean,
it was a good idea. It was a good guess. What was that?
Memories, because it's frontal part of the brain. Memories.
Doesn't have anything to do with it. Doesn't matter where it's located.
Yeah.
And the
but good try.
The process by which memories become related, and in this case, the resistance to that.
Close, really close.
It's the related, isn't it? It's
the related
it's the
is something to do with something.
Yeah.
The memory usually lasts longer when they go through experience of pain or something really stabbing.
Again, close. So close. Let's just look at this again. Lyotard considers intensities as unbound excitations of force. That itself sounds great, doesn't it? Sounds like your dog is like running around. You ever have that? Excitations of force, which are characterized by their displaceability, their instantaneity, and their resistance to the temporal syntheses of memory. So something's being resisted.
Oh, I've managed to think of it. Do you mind?
Okay. Just wait 1 second, because I think you probably have got it. What do you think?
I think that if we think of memory, many things are not coming into, I don't know, that we are not remember them, but because of the intensity, they are there. We remember them while we didn't notice them.
The three
before.
Good, good. This is getting warmer. Actually, it's getting quite warm in this room.
Yeah, Fred.
This is saying you can't remember the feeling of an intensity, but you can remember something, an event which had intensity.
Well, according to Dane, you can definitely remember the feeling of the intensity.
Right.
Right? Isn't that right?
You relate to condensation.
See, a PhD student, you just, yeah, true.
Most memories reconstituted or synthesized.
Yes.
But they're saying in the case of intensities, it's resistant to that. It sort of
gets
through the synthesis. It comes through unaltered.
Yes. But it's not a pure memory, because there's not such thing as a pure memory, right?
I suppose it's more like the real thing than most memories.
Could you build
the most memories are just made up, aren't they? They're constructed.
Okay, well, I just gave you a memory of something that happened, right?
But it won't be exactly as it happened.
Not at all. In fact, as a storyteller, I've sort of made it so that it's a little bit more,
yeah.
And I've left out all the legal issues that, you know, sort of cropped up and things like that.
It's a story, not that it's a story, because that means that when you start a story, the end is in where you start, kind of thing, like it's a thing which is across time, so it's kind of synthesized across time in that respect. So maybe if you have a memory, normally when something happens, you have a memory of it, and you tend to think of the thing which happened before in terms of the thing which happened after. Like, this is the time before the door just slammed, but when it intensely happens, you didn't know it was going to happen, and then afterwards you can't process it. You haven't processed it in that way, or you can't process it in that way.
Close, but not yet there. Amrit, what are you thinking?
It sounds a bit like this intensity is the plane of imminence, and that it is... It is the as present as you can get without representation. It's as close as being as you can get to.
Luckily, Amrit is not going to write the paper this year, because you would have scored very high, and everybody would have been shocked. Can you explain it again? You're right, that is what it is.
The plane of imminence is, from what I understand of it, is about as being within something as much as you can, and that's kind of what the intensity sounds like. It's not... resistance has a resistance to memory, so there's no representation, but it exists in its kind of most present form, which is the intensity.
That was good, that was close.
Mm-hmm. Is there something to do with an alternative language, be it where mediation is unmediated in the sense that it's not tampered with or synthesized?
Yes.
We've stopped using this word mediated, haven't we?
We have, yes.
Because we're not doing it. But we could use the word unmediated.
Because we're banned. No, think of it this way, but you're right. Were you going to add something to this?
I can, but you're doing it.
That's right, go ahead.
I was thinking of an intensity to the Velasian languages, we seem to, as being like a nodal point in a sense. As something that, what's the word? Not transcends. Something that, as it displaces, that's the word I think that's key. That's what I missed out with my original response. It displaces, and that's the key, I think. Everything else I said, plus the displacing.
What does it displace?
It displaces the relationships that, because it's a magnification, because it's a, you know, an excitation, it's unbound, and therefore it cannot be bound.
That's definitional.
Yeah, but
and also, if you think about the Heideggerian relation of A to A, it's unbound too.
Yes.
There's no boundary to it.
No, there's no boundary, but...
So, let's just, before we lose everybody again, because everybody was almost there, now, a skeleton on your hand.
Yes.
That's quite good. The idea of memory that isn't itself representational means that it can't have been cognated. So the idea that you bring something into the shock, whatever that is, and let's call it like memory or whatever that is, the residue of it when you get out of the shock, that moment is not cognized. So it's got a different logic that's going to it. It's a different it's a different type of logic. Again, logic of energy, the logic of sense, the logic of raw power, by which doesn't mean you're going to get run over. It just means that you can't translate it into, the minute you translate it, it's now become a something. So the intensity and the variations of the intensity exist right, by the fact that they can be displaced, they're instantaneous, and they resist cognition. So it's very similar to Kierkegaard's notion of tremble. Same idea. So the tremble seems a little more gentle, doesn't it? Whereas intensity, especially when we're talking about chopping off fingers, blocking the face, you know, these peaks, 0-1 peaks, they're much more intense. Okay, so...
Johnny, is that a bit like when Dave was saying, when you said, oh, how did it happen, and you sort of said it all just happened at once, it's almost like you couldn't describe it afterwards because it's just, you can't process it almost.
But it does matter, right? It makes matter happen.
Also, go right back to King Nestor remembers, it's when King Nestor tells the story to Telemachus, Odysseus' son, it's not an act of representation, it's not an act of making a ground out of history or an accurate representation of events. It's about being able to generate a movement to allow Telemachus to carry on moving.
Yes. Say it again, they didn't get it. No, see, don't forget that one aspect of the whole course is about how something is made to be understandable. Normally, the understandability of something has to do with whether or not it has a ground. How do you make it solid? You link it to the ground. But if you don't have a ground, if you've gotten rid of the ground in the Heideggerian move, which is why you have this unbounded relationality going on A to A, then how does it work? How does it make the work work? And so Dane has very nicely pointed up the story of King Nestor remembers, and if you remember the story of King Nestor remembering, is that he remembers something that never happened because he wasn't there. He knows nothing about it. Who knows why he's telling Telemachus what's going on? Telemachus needs to know: is my father A, alive, and B, a hero? And you know, and King Nestor can tell him, well, you know, your dad's dead, but on the other hand, he was really a hero. And he just spins this whole story up. And what is that about? You might have finished the lecture well.
Yeah. Well, in the Odyssey, Telemachus tries to find these answers. Odysseus went missing away from his home, away from his ground, let's say, away from his identity, where he was a ruler,
or is known,
yeah,
loved.
Exactly, and so he needs to know what happened to him to sort of bring it back together and sort of complete, to build a monument to his father in his homeland, to make him remembered to be immortal. So in order to do that, he has to go on his own journey to find out what happened to him. What did he do during the War of Troy? How was he a hero? And how that's done is by visiting these other people who remember this and don't remember, and how they build. He builds this own myth. He builds his own legend, in a sense.
Good.
For the people he's related with, things he's done, they all contribute to this.
And then, in a certain sense, by doing that, he creates a certain form of intensity that helps him go forward.
He's not creating an identity per se, but he's making it a myth.
Yes. He's creating an intensity, which allows him to have a fluid form of an identity. And that's what Lyotard is talking about here. He's saying, if you think about identity as representational, you're only going to get caught in another trap. So you have to think of identity as, I don't know if motivated is the right word, but moved by the way in which the ground is in fact a mobius strip. It's a libidinal strip, it's a libidinal economy, and the way in which that libidinal economy moves and takes shape, he calls the tensor band. So the tensor band and the libidinal economy are kind of the same word. Sometimes they take their own image and play with it themselves. So the tensor band sometimes is just a bar in his work, and sometimes it's actually a mobius strip. But all of these things are anti-geometry. See, you brought Mandelbrot down here. It's an anti-Euclidean geometry. Now, don't get thrown by that word, Euclidean. He's trying to suggest that there's a different way in which something is made to make sense and something is made to work, and that you have to get rid of the notion of identity based on representation, and in fact, art based on representation, which does not mean you don't have figures in your art, or discourses, or abstractions, or whatever. It means that you start thinking in terms of the flu, No, you start thinking in terms of the way in which the turning of the band, the energies of the band, are moderated or accelerated or somehow dealing with this point of intensity. Because once you understand intensity is not a cognitive thing, but it's something that emerges because of the way the band is operating, because of the way different things are coagulating, then you have a stronger sense, a more heterogeneic sense of how to create. You want to say any more to that? Yeah, okay. did you bring Mandelbrot down here for any reason other than you had it with you?
Well, I'm reading it. It's on the reading list for today.
Yes. No, but I mean, in terms of what we're saying right now. Maybe it's too early yet to bring that in.
If these intensities emerge off the band, are they not just positives?
Yes. Yes. So that's the next thing.
They're what?
Dispositives. So that's the next thing. An intensity can be something that, like we were showing, like this memory issue that is not cognized, but the minute it becomes cognized, it can become deposited on the band. And then you can return to it. And it's like returning to the well. You can dine out on it. It can help you, it can guide you.
So it's only not cognized in the moment.
Cognized in the moment.
But it can be... hindsight?
Not in hindsight, just in...
But it'd be through the logic of the sense.
What's that now?
Wouldn't it be cognized through the logic of the sense?
It's cognized through the logic of the senses, as opposed to through a rational positioning.
Oh.
So it's an intensity, it's an event, is it?
Intensity is an event.
Right.
Very well done. Yeah, so...
What is cognized?
It means to intellectually understand something,
mm-hmm.
and therefore to already bring to it certain positions that you have, because you're thinking it through a certain framework, a certain paradigm. Whereas if you're enabling just a relationship to be established via the senses, there's a different energy involved.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what's being...
It's a brain work, basically. No.
It's not the
logic.
Brain. I mean, it's a different form of logic. Just write down different form.
Cognition.
Oh, I
cognitive.
See. Cognition. Yeah. Right? Oh, sorry.
Once you cognized it, would you have to do that in terms of things which weren't it? Then it would have things which were it, things which weren't it. And would that mean that it was folding up into a theatrical volume? Or is that
yes, that's right. Can you explain a little bit more?
Because if you can only cognize something in terms of something which was outside itself.
Okay, yeah, well,
so
it's outside.
It has an inside and outside, therefore it is no longer...
It doesn't have
just
an inside and outside.
Right, so, but isn't that what happens to things which become theatrical volumes?
When you say theatrical, so it's not so much that there's an inside and outside to the theatrical volume. What's the advantage you get, or one gets, from calling it a volume, a theatrical volume?
I suppose because it has another dimension.
Good.
And that dimension could be a form. I mean, if you have like a two-dimensional thing, and then you fold it up into three dimensions, and you can do that kind of operation as well, maybe that's relevant, I'm not sure.
No, it's very relevant, because what we're moving here is that we're moving into theories of dimensions, as opposed to of... geometry as such, as opposed to what normally is. You probably don't think about it this way, maybe you don't think about it this way, maybe you do. But a lot of thought within modern and postmodern thinking is rooted in planes and triangles and squares. In other words, different forms of different geometric shapes. Lyotard's trying to get rid of that. So was Deleuze, for that matter. They're trying to talk about folds. Trying to talk about bands, libidinal bands, and so on. But Deleuze, according to Lyotard, still remains caught in a geometric, or in a, I'd say, mathematically symbolic environment, whereas what Lyotard's trying to do is remove it out of planes and get into dimensions. So you're going to be talking about light, speed, heat, and these become part of the whole sort of story.
Topology.
Yes.
Sort of like dimensions and surfaces rather than dimensions and, you know,
yes, absolutely. Yes, absolutely.
Yeah. I was just thinking. I think that's how I sort of envisage the planes. Deleuze's different planes anyway, not being actual sort of planes.
Yeah. No, they're not.
They're sort of talked about in a geometric way.
Yes, and Lyotard's trying to even get rid of that.
Right.
But it is, you can make a very, and people do, and I think those people, including Deleuze and Guattari, do make the notion of the plane of immanence as dimensional.
They talk about speed rather than heat,
don't they? Yeah, that's right. Mm. But because Lyotard is interested in the erotics, in erotic praxis, he's going to try and bring into the fold, as it were, into the surface, how does the erotic actually end up not being brought in, but is already part of the story.
Right.
Okay?
Yeah.
Okay. Helen, why don't you read the next sentence?
Lyotard radicalizes, however, Freud's understanding of psychic intensity, since libidinal intensities cannot be willed, even by the unconscious, and describe the forces running through the band as a whole, and not just a so-called part of it.
So what do you make of that?
Sorry, I've lost you.
It's okay. So we're under 12.
Okay. Oh, yes.
Lyotard radicalizes.
Yep.
Freud's understanding of psychic intensity. So by radicalizing the notion of psychic intensity, if you remember with Freud basically says the psychic intensity is in the unconscious. That's where it is. And what Lyotard's saying is that it is actually part of the atmosphere, is part of the whole world.
We don't bring things upon ourselves. Freud says that we kind of drive ourselves towards certain things because of what our experiences or our upbringing. He says that the things that happen without us kind of guiding ourselves.
It's not really the point that he's made. What he's trying to get at is thinking more of Panos's work in terms of vulnerability.
Mm-hmm.
So when you think about the way in which one deals with this thing called the vulnerable, it is an encounter. It's not an experience as such. Experience gets put aside because experience is already cognizing something. It's more raw than that. And he's trying to get into the fact that this, what happens in that radicalization of psychic intensity is that it runs through the whole way in which the ground, or the groundless ground, that is say the libidinal band, begins to then organize the fight or flight, the positioning, the confrontation of the experience. So, and he says here, it is through an organizing and regulatory central instance, for example, the great zero, that the singularity of an intensity becomes a communicatable and exchangeable sign. So what does that mean? What does it mean to become a communicatable and exchangeable sign?
What is not able to be looked at?
What is it not able to do? What?
To explain it, to verbalize it.
Okay,
what
so.
Is in becoming.
So once. Yes, go on, sorry.
So what is. On a sense, now it becomes when. The bar slows down.
Good.
To become able to explain it.
Yes.
It's an economy.
And that's when it's an economy. Ooh. Goosebumps. Okay, that's really sad. That's what my friend is very exciting. By the way, anybody notice my scarification attacks? This is my ability not to be able to cook. That is taking vegetables out of the oven.
Ouch.
I firmly believe that anyone in the room can cook for me, cook dinner, or I eat cold food. I hate cooking. I just want to say that. I know that's wrong, I know it's bad, but look at this. It looks like I tried to do some sort of weird ritual. Okay. I point that out, again, going through these like different stories, which may seem unattached, but they're all part of the libidinal band. The question becomes, that little story I just told you about the cooking, and how you could relate to it, how you couldn't, how you got the joke, how you didn't get the joke, how you were bored with the joke, how you like want to just stay on point with this thing. All of that comes together to create the slowing down of the bar. And when the bar gets slowed, according to the argument, that's when you have an economy.
But how does that, I don't understand, how do we slow the bar down? How does that work?
Over to you, Dane.
You have to find a way to allow it to enter into relation with the things we can say, speak, do, and in doing that we slow it just enough so it materializes, it gains a form which we can handle, do something with.
So in my going into my scarification approach to life, cooking, I slowed down. Now maybe I slowed it so far down that you ended up thinking, okay, I was following it and now we're over here in the land of kitchens, so maybe got lost. But the idea is that you get to a point where you were still in the story, you're still listening to the story, you're still brought into the moment, but it's been slowed down. So now the question I ask you is, how are you now thinking through that intensity? How do you now engage with it? Not just an abstract notion of intensity, but any of the intensities that are in your life. Yeah, Fred. Thanks.
Is it making sense?
Yes, it's literally like needing sense, but not just any old sense, that which can be made into sense.
I'm not saying this because I understand. I actually ask because, in this sense, I actually don't. Is the economy created? Because if I think of this as being the bar slowing down, because we're able to.
You think about it as what? The bar slowing down.
The bar slowing down. Okay. The bar slowing down. when things. When this it, whatever it may be, an intensity, enters in relation to other things, we're able to, let's say, arrive more times, let's say, in that slowing down. And thus the economy is created because we're able to understand a lack and an exchange. Because
yeah,
I was thinking,
it's no lack, it's no slowing, it's no arrival.
Okay.
It's an expression. It's an encounter.
Okay.
And it's in the encounter that the meaning comes to bear.
So then it's not the kind of, because when I read this I thought I understood it. so the economy then is a different kind of economy altogether. It's not
yes.
It's not transactional.
Right.
It's more like the economy of a car and an apple in their relationships. They're different nouns, but they when they occupy the same space, they have different presences, and
right.
That's the economy.
That's
yes.
The economy.
Awesome.
Yeah, very good.
Are we into language yet? Is that what we're talking about?
Not quite. I mean, we're obviously into language on one level.
Language
but
is an economy, isn't it?
Yes, but let's just stick with the word economy here as something that is both something that has to do with exchange, but also has to do with circulation. And it also has to do with the shortest way to say something. Like an algorithm is simply an economy of a long series of zero and ones that you can then come up with something that is very tight. So economy means that things are made into shorter, tighter moments. So economy has now three different variations just now. One is the transaction, as you were saying, one is circulation. and one is this way of saying something in shorthand.
Mm.
You know, he was economical with the truth. She was economical with what she did. Or if you say that someone's being economical, it usually means that they're thrifty. They're able to make things last longer because they're doing something that shortens. What are we going to add to that? Because you were the one that brought the comment.
Yeah, it was done.
Yes,
it
was
done. It was all the problems.
So no color.
Yeah.
Yeah, if you say it enters into an economy, you still have to figure out the rules of transaction. What's,
yeah.
What are things worth? What are you willing to sell something for? To give something away? To take something? What's the cost? That's still not defined. That's has to be worked through in the making.
Yeah. So all of, yeah, James?
During this period of this process of economy, isn't it not a kind of a withdrawal?
Can be.
A kind of a withdrawal to be able to maybe start all over again.
You can withdraw and have debt, for example, in an economy. He gets into this whole thing with, you know, the ethical debts.
Yeah.
The debt of, you know, like what happens if, he starts talking about what happens if you are wanting to go in terms of pagan theatrics in the paganized way, but of course you'll be ostracized in so doing. So there's a debt, there's a exchange you have to do even within the exchange to be able to just live.
I mean, it could be deliberate or spontaneous in this sense, no?
Yep.
Yes, or no? Okay.
Mm-hmm. Okay, yes? Let's just, I want to, I'm not sure if you're getting the full thing here. The tensor sign is a description of this attempt, which is, let's just skip that for a little. Let's go to now the actual great ephemeral skin, which we began last week. I just want to see one thing.
The chapter and the definition.
The chapter. You know, where the whole thing is cut open again and whatever. Let's just make sure. I'm not sure we're covering everything here. Okay, so if you look on the course outline, week 10, March 15, see, I don't want you to get so lost in this that it just becomes just seemingly crazy and difficult. But what's trying to be put forward here is this way in which I start understanding how this tensor band, which can be the libidinal economy, creates a movable surface. It creates a surface that is malleable. This is why they call it an ephemeral skin. Skin because it's malleable, breathable. Ephemeral because it goes on forever. But it goes on forever in a kind of non-real way. Again, I mean, I think I mentioned this many times, that I have said to my supervisor, my PhD supervisor, the first one.
That's the question.
Wait. Which was that, you know, he was a very terrible supervisor, unfortunately, and he didn't understand feminism. And I remember pointing out the window and saying that we had there's a huge feminist movement, and he had to quite kind of understand this. And he went to the window and he's like, oh, really? Well, I don't see the movement. Where's the movement? Where's the feminist movement? It's, in a certain sense, ephemeral, but incredibly real, totally real. So that's true of everything that you guys are doing. Your artwork, can be ephemeral, but that's the world that you're in. And it has a very real set of materialities, which Lyotard is calling the ephemeral skin. So even though my supervisor was incapable of seeing the fact that he was incapable of seeing the ephemeral skin, you're not. You get how this whole thing is operating. So the tensor band, we know that this is a way of thinking, a type of materiality that both enables some kind of encounter to happen and at the same time is the encounter. So it enables an encounter, but it is the encounter. Just like your artwork can enable your experience of an artist or your being an artist, but at the same time, it is the artwork. What's happened, the whole process becomes the artwork. Got it. So there's a comment here about how the tensor band enables a framing, but at the same time it has something that is decaying about it, something that isn't always, it can never stop, it can never be totally fixed. And this is where Lyotard gets into the question of how complexity and entanglement, well, it's not how he gets into it, but it's how you can get into it. Because the problem of complexity or entanglement is precisely now trying to figure out when you have an ephemeral surface that actually has a materiality as hard, as strong as going through a concrete wall or hitting yourself. You know, we talked about racism off, you know, in the class. So when you, if someone else can't see it, it's not the problem of the person who's being attacked by that. It's the problem of the person who's facilitating it. They don't even realize. Trump, for example, I told you last time with his finding of the one woman in all of America who could build the Trump Towers, that he didn't see this as in any way perpetuating a certain kind of skin, a certain kind of ephemeral reality that hurts and is as confining as though it were actually, you know, a solid scenario. Fred, were you going to say anything? Okay. So this question of entanglement is a comment drawn from quantum physics. The word entanglement, on the one hand, does do exactly like what it sounds like. It's getting meshed into things, but the meshing aren't of little ingredients that get thrown together. They themselves are these weird slices of time, slices of sense, slices of place. So in order to understand fully what's being said here, is that Lyotard, what you're being asked to do in your mind, in your thinking, in your practice, to figure out how to think plurally, how to think heterogeneically, and when you can do this, when this dimensional thinking comes in, I hope that it becomes clearer what the entanglement procedures are about, what the way in which complexity operates. Can you bring in a little bit more about that, and then we'll go back to the ephemeral skin?
Try using an example. Let's say entanglement in terms of sexism, let's say, how would you say, who was it that started sexism? Who was the first person to be sexist? Couldn't really
find that person.
Yeah, exactly. It doesn't come from a singular origin, it's plural, it spreads out charismatically. You can't just cut off someone and the whole movement fall apart, there's no head.
Yeah.
It spreads, and entanglement's the same sort of thing. There's no one dominant force that's allowing the something to spread to become real or hardy. Everything is moving, it's in the same sort of way, acknowledging where all the other bits are moving as well, but not connecting them in a way which forms a solid hierarchical structure which allows the head to emerge, a form which directs everybody. Everyone's moving in their own sort of way, but they're also moving together.
Yeah.
That, yeah, it's a sort of...
Is that... Are you hearing that?
Yeah.
So I think that's a very good example, actually. It's quite a good example.
Like ants.
Like ants.
Mm.
Except literally, like if you wanted to find ground zero of who is the first sexist, you would never find this first sexist.
Ants don't work because they submit to a hierarchy.
Yeah.
They really submit to a hierarchy because...
Queen.
But I think, don't you think a ground has been created in that sense?
In the sense of which sense?
Because, like he said they submitted to a hierarchy because of the order.
Well, in the ant scenario, but not in the entanglement scenario.
Mm.
But a ground does get, that's the whole point, a ground does get created, but the ground is an ephemeral ground.
Yeah.
But that it's ephemeral doesn't mean it doesn't hurt, doesn't mean it doesn't stop, doesn't mean it... What it means is that it can be broken, but it's not necessarily obvious how it can be broken.
It's not static anyway.
It's not static. Exactly. Nick?
I'm just going to say, I think a sort of ant colony, though, it's not a sort of vertical hierarchy, is it? You can see it more, that the sort of collective of the colony, and that sort of throws up the queen. And I was just going to ask if this is very helpful, because I was going to ask this question anyway. Trump. He gets thrown up. He's not the cause of it all. He gets thrown up by the...
He's like the queen ant.
Yes, but he's the result of it all, isn't he?
He's not an agitator.
That's right.
Yeah, is he a node or something?
Well, I mean...
But there was racism and all these awful isms that he seems to personify. Sort of, they're all there before the Trump.
Yes, that's right.
He will invent anything.
No, absolutely.
People talk about Hitler and Nazism. He was sort of inevitable that there would be a Hitler. It just happened to be him.
Well, the same thing. It's like it's kind of inevitable that it would be a Donald Trump.
Yes.
But it turns out to be that guy. Now, it's not necessarily, it's not so inevitable that it has to be
him.
Inevitable in that sense.
No.
But what makes it conceivably inevitable is, again, we get back to entanglements. You have all these scenarios going on. And at some point, there can be kismet. You know, there can be this moment.
Yes.
And it's not just out of the sky. I mean, things happen.
Yes.
To make it happen.
But it's as a result of the...
Yes, and then it's like being in the right place at the right time, essentially. But that's still too facile in a way, because if you have a chance, all of you should take a look at populism, what it means to talk about populism. There's a number of people in history that have been populist leaders, and the most famous one, a most famous one that you might know of because you might have seen Evita, is Perón from Argentina. And Perón was a right-wing populist, not unlike Donald Trump. I mean, sorry about that. Probably it's not like Donald Trump, but in the sense that Donald Trump is essentially right-wing, whatever else he is. And the right-wingness that he has, he is able to evoke, you know, the phobias, the homophobia, you know, the unemployment, racism, whatever the various issues are, nationalism, and so on and so forth. But he's able to do this by arguing, as somebody said in some newspaper cartoon, that he's the people's billionaire, which is, I think, you know, yeah, that's about right.
That's wonderful.
Yeah. You know,
irony.
Yeah, he presents... You could do it too. The reason you haven't done it is because you're an idiot. You know, whereas I, Donald, am smart.
It's quite an interesting story. I was watching one of these things that just pop up on Facebook. These two black men were going to go and like kind of passively protest at a Donald Trump rally. So they were wearing like the Black Lives Matter T-shirt, and by their mere kind of presence there, it wasn't Donald Trump who said anything, but the audience automatically acted
turn on them
aggressively.
Yeah.
And then Donald Trump could just stand there and say, right, now we can get started. So it's even as though he doesn't even have to be instigator in that situation.
Mm-hmm.
It
is interesting.
It slows
down one of the... There's a fantastic thing that's going around social media right now on Donald. It's done by what's that guy's name? Who is a political analyst? He's like a comedian political. It's not John. I can't think of his name.
John Oliver.
If you Google John Oliver and Donald Trump, it's like a 20-minute brilliant discussion on Trump.
Oliver is brilliant.
He is brilliant, I have to say. But this is even for Oliver, this is like...
John Oliver.
Yeah, John Oliver, really great. And then there is a very good write-up on Trump in the Rolling Stone, of all places, where they really go through, you know, what's going on. But anyway, not to get off on that too much, but the idea is that solidifications happen because they can. Sometimes things can solidify into a cohesive relationship, often because people fight to make it happen. People take a stand, people throw the donut, people have the, you know, there's a revolution. You weren't here when we talked about the donut throwing, but anyway, that was the start of Stonewall. But sometimes things happen because they can happen. That's why. There is no reason. No reason other than the fact that, boom, it happened. It happens. And this is where the entanglement question comes in. How does entanglement, if it's not static, so these movements are happening, what happens to make things stick? Which is not to say on the one, because all of these guys we've been looking at are very political, and none of them are suggesting that you should not be political. You can just sort of hang out and things will change. Things change because you have to make them change. But in order to make them change, you sort of have to have a sense of the bigger picture. The bigger picture means a sense of the smaller picture, which is the ephemera and the tensor bands and the ways in which the intensity happens, how this band erupts. Now, this moves into two different areas, which I'm going to mention now. There was a breath in the back? No. I'm going to mention that. One is the question of the fractal, which in your mind, do you know what a fractal is? I've done it a few times, but mm-hmm. You were nodding. What's a fractal?
Well, no. It repeats itself over and over again.
Okay, but what's the difference between a fractal and a fragment?
The scale, like even when you go into it, the smaller scale, it's sort of there's like a symmetry to it, a kind of repetition of patterns.
No, but it's a good, yeah.
The fragment is a piece of something, and
yes,
the fractal is a piece of something which is itself,
yes,
also the something.
Yes,
it's a kind of a pseudopodic movement.
That's
repeats itself.
It's again, looking at my forest management development policy.
Crystals are used as example.
What do you mean, why?
Because if you break up, because crystals observably fractalize, the verb, so if you, to use your word fragment, if you broke off a fragment of a crystal and then put it somewhere else, it would fractalize. It would get larger and grow, just as it would anywhere.
And if it's in the same
shape. It's not like breaking a piece of glass where you get a fragment off it, or a photo where it's incomplete without the rest. A crystal is a natural example of a fractal, because it grows the same wherever it is. It contains all its own ingredients.
But it's producing itself.
Okay, again, following the impossible ability of my cooking, Fred, you have to come save the world here when you're cooking. This is a pie, okay? It's not a very round pie, but it's a pie. And that's a slice of the pie. So you would say, let's say this pie isn't... So we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 slices. So that slice is a fragment. It's 1/5 the pie. But if we've gotten out of totalities, we've gotten out of universalities, unities, then one has to start thinking about how does a piece that materializes as ephemera, as a materiality, but it doesn't have any weight, and it doesn't have any body, except it does have a body, and it does have weight, it does create stoppages and starts. It has, one way to talk about it is a slice. You're right that fractals multiply in an exact proportion, but they also, in so doing, create rough edges as opposed to smooth edges. Now over to Dane to explain how this, the difference between how a fractal creates roughness.
Does it dimensionally, essentially?
Okay, want to show, the hold up the book. Mandelbrot. Okay, can you explain what happens? The key here is the dimensional. Key, just keep thinking about dimensions.
I might need a bit of paper.
Here, use my performance review.
So let's say you've got a line. It's one dimensional. It's a one dimensional line. So.
And why is it one dimensional?
It's got one extension. It's length. It doesn't have a depth. It doesn't have a height.
Good.
It's got an x. Let's say. So the point would be zero because it has no extension, no x and y. Plane, square root dimension 2, because it has.
It extends in two ways.
Yeah. And if you've got, say, something like this, what is that 2D, 1D? Turns out that it's actually got a dimension between 1 and 2D, so that would be.
Trick question.
Yeah. Sadly, so it's got a dimension of about 1.5 or something like that, so. It's not exactly a line, but it's not exactly a plane either. So, same with coastlines, they don't fill a whole plane, but again, they're not exactly just a line. So they start to fill these in-between spaces. They don't become smooth, whole dimensions either, but they are sort of whole dimensions, like in Deleuze talks about how the rhizome fills its own dimensions.
Mm-hmm.
Those dimensions aren't whole, smooth surfaces.
They're striated.
Striated, yeah. So they retain a roughness which goes on and on to infinity, no matter how much you move through it or zoom in towards it. Yeah, it still retains an edge, and it's at the edge where things change, where things produce these strange, we call them monsters, monster curves, and that change, yeah, is monstrous. It can take all sorts of strange and odd forms.
How many people actually had a chance to read the fractal stuff? Oh, very good. What'd you get out of it?
We watched videos.
You watched the videos, well done. Excellent.
Thanks today.
That's right.
Constructing the wave.
Good. What do you make of it? What
special effects?
What does it make for your own work? We're trying to get you to see. This is tough work, and we're just skimming the very, very surfaces of it. So it's kind of like you have these little glasses on and trying to see the roughness stuff. What Dane is expressing here is how. Is basically the question that gets put forward in a way that isn't put forward the way Lyotard is doing. Lyotard is like the paganistic, the theatrics, the volume, this kind of thing. The intensities, the bar, the spinning bar, the ephemeral skin, the ripping, the cutting up, the duodenum, and so on and so forth. He's in a much more, you know, vulgar, obscene way that he's talking about this stuff. And the vulgarity is important for him. Move over to Mandelbrot, Benoit Mandelbrot, and he's asking the question, bizarrely it's the same question, how is it that the coastline is rough? When you look at a coastline, when you walk along a coastline, it's not like there's a line and then suddenly it drops off to the sea or whatever the thing is. When you see dawn emerging, which is a beautiful moment, or dusk, when it starts doing this odd changeover, there's no line. It's not smooth. He calls it the roughness. So he wanted to think through the theory of roughness, and there were no tools to do this. And he cracked it by thinking in terms of what he calls these slices, these fractals.
Mm-hmm.
Because he started looking at trees and he realized the leaves on the trees had these, you know, they got smaller and smaller in the leaves, and they, you know,
mm-hmm.
if you look at a tree, any tree that hasn't been pulleted, I digress. The beauty of how the majesty of these trees and the kind of wildness of them. So it might not look like there are these symmetrical moments happening. And it's not so much you have to pixelate down and telescope into the very tiny, tiny, tiny. It's that they actually dimensionally create the roughness. Right? Okay. Can you show them your work? Because I think that this might...
Is it about roughness?
It's about not smoothness.
Yeah.
Oh, very good. Thank you. And can you explain what you're showing us?
This is a atlas.
Yes.
Of the coastline.
Of
England.
Good.
As an island.
I want to put it toward the... Good. And?
It's rough.
Yes. And what do you, when you say rough, what do you mean by that?
It's...
And don't say not smooth.
Okay. The edges are not flat. They have...
Not flat, mm-hmm. they have...
Can it be applied to a painting?
Yes.
In this one case?
All paintings.
Please?
Let's not do that yet. Let's...
No?
Let's apply it to Dane's work first. Oh, that's great. Can you explain that? That's great.
It's just... you just start off with like two lobes, as it were, and then you draw two lobes as you go round. That one's not quite right. But anyway, you draw two lobes for each time you go round one, and then so you carry on going around the outside. And that's all you're doing, you just carry on, and then you end up with this kind of like almost like a circle surface of like, it would carry on, it would get microscopic very quickly if you carried on, so you kind of carry on until you can't do any more. It's just a really quick way of generating something
great.
Which has roughness.
Or like snowflakes, because that is that they really want to.
Or that's really like a flower, even.
Yeah.
It's like reflective of lots of things in nature in that way, so but that's a great bit.
Yeah, French pass it around so people can look at it. So, ready? Thank you. So, that's important to understand. Okay, so let's be clear what we're doing here, or as clear as we can be. We started the lesson at 3 o'clock today. Trying to understand how a surface exists in a one-dimensional way. So Dane drew a line and it was a one-dimensional thing, but if we could stretch that line without it becoming two-dimensional, if we could make it a fat line, you know, then, because when you draw a line, it's got some sort of width to it, so you could really say, well, actually, that's actually a very thin rectangle line, because if your thing was that, you know, strong. But if we could pull it out, just like, you know, make it come out somehow, and still have it as one dimensional, that's the craziness of what we're talking about here. That's what your work does. All of your works do this. You play on this domain, this environment of the one dimension, or when you do go to two dimension, that is, say, let's think of the square so things can go in different directions, or three dimensions, four dimensions gets even more weird, five dimensions is kind of, then we're now in string theory, six dimensions, seven dimensions, so on. But these dimensions enable ephemera to create. Now what Dane works on, I mean, he'll explain in a second, but he develops the way in which the senses create or are encoded in the making of the ephemera as a surface, as a one-dimensional, two-dimensional, three-dimensional environment. Ready? Okay. Do you realize that this is the first time we've had our course with the lights on?
So this work, essentially just draws lines of random colour. It's got rules, it draws straight lines of random colour, but both vertically and horizontally.
Can people see it, okay?
For a certain amount of time, then as when that time reaches a limit, it erase lines, so it draws black lines to erase what's already gone, but it doesn't completely erase everything. It leaves these little spots or these rough bits, and then when it reaches a certain time again, that feeds back into the original algorithm, and it starts again to draw new lines, and it repeats itself like that. So it hits a limit, goes back, then does it again. And the important bit that it's not reversible in the sense it never resets. Its time is continuous in a sense, but it does repeat itself. It allows itself to generate complex imagery, to repeat itself, but without simply starting over again. It has a life to it, has a lifespan to it, which it needs to develop, to generate. And what it generates is it's increasingly complex or rough spots, nodes, bits, which contribute to a strange sort of imagery
right.
that has a temporality embedded in it somehow.
Okay, I want you to explain it again. This time, can you turn the lights off? See if we can see it better. And that light on.
Oh.
A little. Yeah. Oh. Yeah, perfect. Okay.
So, as the program runs, it produces lines of colour at various intensities, colour lines, and it also erases those, takes them away, but doesn't take them away completely, so...
And why doesn't it take them away completely?
Because it's the placement of lines, it's this act of getting rid of things isn't systematic, it's random in a sense, so it doesn't try to erase everything at once. And in the time span it's got, it doesn't have the time to do so.
So it's programmed to start with leftovers, what was not
erased
completely, but it will start again.
It keeps what's gone before, so it never stops or resets. It's just continuing to run. It has a lifespan to it, which...
But we don't see it within a human eye, with our case, it's computer can see it, isn't it? Because I don't see those dots where...
It depends on...
But
it doesn't see the dots are very small, but it's not just the dots, it's the gaps in the lines, it's a mixture of colours. Every time it runs, it can generate something, a different set of colours, and those colours, lines, combinations, bits, all produce different sorts of intensities every time it runs. So sometimes you might be drawn to this bit here, but that other times it might be drawn to a dark bit here. And those things are never set in stone either. Those are all, they've been continually erased, redrawn, recombined into different moments of mixtures.
So it's not random by any means, is it?
No, it's got something to it.
Yeah.
But it's not.
It's not.
You can't capture that moment in a certain way. It's always escaping in a sense.
Of course, yeah. Because, those lines, like you explained, they are random lines, which sometimes elusive but reoccurring.
Mm-hmm.
Cannot really capture it. So when they reoccur, create another form which is similar to the actual line that is present.
But when I say, the program is written randomly, it's sort of progressing.
Yeah.
The program is not programmed in terms of if yes go one way, if no go another way. It's a program that learns as it goes, which is also creepy.
Mm-hmm.
Now, can anybody take a look at this and see how this kind of work has some resonance on your own work? Can anybody see their own? I mean, obviously Dane's doing a very specific thing, but we're talking about the way in which surfaces are created, the ephemeral, can you keep that on for a second? No, take it off. Like James, can you think about how your work resonates with this?
I suppose in terms of overhearing conversations that are not I don't know in control as to where the sentences come, but at the same time I am selecting.
Yes.
So there's a process of sort of randomness, but also order.
So the selecting comes from some form of memory.
Yes.
But the memory itself is not pre-thought.
Yes.
Something like that.
Okay.
Is that right? Okay. Fred, what about you? Can you think about how this links with your work?
I think there's this, very recently it seems to be this idea of attention.
Oh, good.
Or what is to be kind of, to be paid attention to. So I suppose there are certain resonances with the kind of the program, reprogram itself and what is left behind or kind of lost.
And when you're talking about the paying of attention, what makes you have attention? For Lyotard, he's talking about the tensor band, right? So the tensor band creates the intensity. It's the intensity that manufactures attention in that sense. Would you agree with that? Yeah. Oh.
We had one earlier.
Doro's not back yet. That's hilarious. Okay. How's it beginning to sit with you? Good, bad, horrible?
In between. 1.5 dimension.
The 1.5 dimension, that's pretty good, isn't it?
Yeah.
Okay.
Is that not a mathematical trickery?
No, it's not mathematical trickery. You're 1.5 dimensions, right?
No. Well,
it's just a way of trying to measure it, isn't it? Because you can't use...
Because length is...
Length is irrelevant, sort of.
In terms of the measuring of coastline, for example, because you can use a meter stick, use a... 10 centimetre stick, you can use ants, but they all give different measurements.
Yes.
So the way to use dimensions is a way to get a value which isn't so erratic.
But is that not just, when I say not just, it sounds as if yes, I'm belittling it without understanding it, but is that not a, it's not actually allocating dimensions or deriving dimensions from a fractal, it's just a way of measurement that Mandelbrot devised to try and make sense of the thing.
Yeah.
It doesn't actually have that
characteristic. It doesn't have half a dimension, you're saying.
No, it doesn't have 1.5 dimension.
It does have half a...
It does.
Euclidean
it does.
Dimension.
I don't believe
between,
that.
You don't believe that.
No, I don't believe it.
There are lots of like fractal generator programs you can actually download. If you generate it, you see it work. And
yes.
You can... And
well,
you,
My other issue relating to that is I've read somewhere, I'm not going to say where because it was the way everyone was, but that there are actually no natural fractals. What fractals are a mathematical system which approximates to natural features like coastlines and ferns and things, and even they don't repeat more than a couple of generations before they stop. That's my problem. Well, my third problem with fractals is that most of them are derived from very simple formulae, so they can't be considered as complex systems. Now, those are the things I was reading into it last year. I don't know which one you'd like to take first.
Yeah.
Sorry,
take
I was
the last
back.
One first.
What was it?
That was that fractals are not complex systems.
I think Paul Phillips, who is a sort of philosopher from New Zealand, and he's dead now actually, but he did a lot of fractals. He said that they're not complex. They're very interesting, but they're not complex. Somewhere in between. That's what they're interested in.
Well, they are simple. They're simple and complex at the same time. That's what makes them so...
Right.
That's what makes them able to work as mathematics, is to be able to...
The mathematics is simple.
To be able to derive something from them which applies to something. Which
yes.
Just, you know, just making a random value from it that serves no significance. It's actually talking about how things are structured in nature, how they fill, how they grow, fill spaces.
Well, I think the argument was things in nature are structured like fractals, but they're not actually accurately fractal. Is that a word?
But that things in nature are developed according to more pure mathematics than?
Yes.
That be?
And the answer is no, right?
Well, I think that the point being made was that there are no pure mathematical forms in nature, but they do. They are like more like that than they are like triangles and rectangles and circles.
Mm.
So it's a good mathematical system. It gets closer to the actual forms in nature, but it doesn't matter if they don't reflect anything natural because they exist in themselves.
Mm.
But the complexity thing was that a true complex system, its description, because of its heterogeneity or whatever it's called, the description of the system is at least as big as the system itself. And with a fractal, they're based on relatively simple mathematical formulae. Hence, the whole existence of the fractal, mathematically speaking, is within a simple formula. And that was another reason why fractals couldn't be considered complex, or perhaps not as complex as other complex systems.
A description of the system is as big as the system itself, but it has no algorithmic compressibility.
Yeah, that's the word.
Therefore, there is no description of it at all.
Yes. A true complex system cannot be compressible. That was the terminology.
But a compressible system, he says that even if you reduce the system to its most simplistic compressed states, it still has an irreducible infinite randomness to it. So that's similar to the Mandelbrot roughness. No matter how much you reduce something, compress it, it still has a roughness to it.
But you can't compress some of it. So, otherwise you wouldn't be able to compress anything at all.
Yeah, exactly.
But you can't, I think that's the reason, you can't describe, in those terms, you can't describe a complex system. That would be the argument. Because a complex system is not compressible. It's very, might be very, very complicated.
Surely.
Sorry?
You could partially describe it in that you could get to a certain resolution. But you could never, or you could sort of characterize it without actually being able to come up with a system which replicates that exact system.
When you say can't describe it, I mean you can't contain it within a description.
But not describe absolutely, so it's sort of, it's not completely indescribable, it's not completely describable, it's sort of, I don't know, it's more complex than just some of it being described.
Well, you can't define it then, perhaps is the better way of putting it.
You can't define it, you can only ever approximate.
Yes.
Yeah.
But with a fractal you can, because it's a simple equation.
But I wouldn't agree that you can...
I would be careful about saying that because something's simple, it's not working in the same level of sophistication.
But that's why it's fascinating, because it's in one sense it's simple, in another sense it's complex.
But complex not necessarily just meaning difficult. It's complex because it also invokes complexity,
yes.
i.e. a very specific kind of thinking in dimensional terms.
Yes, that's what I mean. If it's very, 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 very complicated, that's what it is, very complicated.
Mm-hmm.
Complexity has certain qualities, and one of them, which is that it's not compressible.
But that it's not compressible doesn't mean that, I'm not sure what the value of it in terms of being non-compressible would be, except to say that if you go back to the Heideggerian move of A equals A, the complexity systems don't allow for the absorption of A equals A, but that's not even true because they could turn into black holes. Let's just put the...
non-compressible systems can still be rough.
And
probably simple.
Yes, absolutely. Now, because we left the last break on Dora's question about, well, what this is all very interesting, but what does that do with art, basically? What does it do with painting? We're now going to have Panos explain it in terms of his work.
So, I have three art books here. I don't know, we should put them somewhere. I
put them so people can see them somehow. Put them in the center of the table, or where you put them on the radiator. It's not on. Oh, is it on? Oh, right, okay. Don't put it on the radiator.
I'm focusing on the ideas of vulnerability. And so the only when you're approaching vulnerability, which something that they realized was that you feel when you actually understand that you are vulnerable by nature when you experience something. And the only way of the way I'm dealing with it is the counter, because that something that makes you realize that you are vulnerable is when you encounter something. And I realize
but
that...
But the encounter isn't something that you experience such.
Yeah.
It is the meeting, yeah.
And the encounter, I understand that that is, let's say, that relation of belonging together, that you are encountered with something with difference, and that difference is able to ground things, but it's not ground. You cannot explain it or make it verbalized what happened, and it produces a change. So in my work, in the link with that in the work is how things emerge in the process of making that we cannot understand why they make sense, but they come to ground and bring a change, and from that change it is understood not at the moment, but later. So I brought three artworks that are kind of, they have a series, what was first and then came after, which are quite new, but I still haven't grasped them. But I know that something pulled my attention to, for example, start unpicking the canvas.
Mm-hmm.
And it maybe was that when I was putting the canvas on the stretcher, lines of the threads were dismantling on the sides,
mm-hmm.
maybe, or something else, I don't know. But from there, I then wanted to paint on that thread.
Mm-hmm.
And from there, I realized that they have a wave, and they create a very distinctive texture.
Mm-hmm.
And from there, it gets to different ideas that, but I don't want to, I know that they are linked, but I don't know what was that brought me from the one to the other. And so at the same time, the encounter is what we the way we see we encounter with difference itself, and at the same time is the artwork in the process, and the artwork itself, it becomes an encounter.
Mm-hmm.
Kind of, and yeah.
And can you explain what makes the within each of the pieces,
mm-hmm.
Like the one that Lily has right now? So it looks like one thing that's quite secure, as it were, in the front, and in the back it's got all these pieces that are falling
yeah.
apart. Can you talk about that piece?
Yes. When I was... that piece came after that one.
Okay.
And I was... And that...
Let's just look at that.
I wanted to combine the vertical threads that it had paint on them with the threads that I have removed. I wanted to kind of remake it as it was with something different. I was sure that it will have a sign that something happened there. So that was the idea. But then it completely get something very different. It created a pull or
mm-hmm.
something.
It crack, you know.
Yeah, a tension.
Yeah,
and from there I got here where I wanted to make those the combination of the lines to be more obvious, so I try to magnify them, make them appear bigger.
So are they braided? Is that what's going on? Is that like...
Yeah, it braided, is. Yeah. It was unpicked, and then I put more strings and put them at the same way again, so it created this bulb.
See, one of the things that was happening in Thomas's work is that he was interested in this problem of vulnerability, but you kept painting what you thought was vulnerable. Okay,
yeah.
Can you explain that?
It was, I had an approach of kind of a representational approach, not only creating an image, but I was thinking also what image can have vulnerability, instead of focusing on what was that sense of being vulnerable at that moment that I felt that. And from there, it was only always, I was trying to skip the mediation or something. So at the beginning, I was creating a big image of a wound, which I thought that a wound could be related with that, because vulnerable is related with wound, as I was thinking about it. So
you were like rationally caught recognizing it as a wound. And then therefore you were painting this thing called wound.
Yes.
Yeah, go on.
And from there I was then trying to, okay, it looks like a wound, but it doesn't feel like that thing. So I was still making the attempt to make it smaller, because I thought that maybe the size, it has a problem that it is not, it can't be a wound so big. So I was going to a smaller size, and then I was experimenting with the texture of kind of trying to express the flesh sense. And from there,
that was still all description, right?
Yeah, it was still the color of the flesh and the quality of the flesh, but the attempt to create the sense of the flesh, kind of something happened there, and just I put everything aside and started to focus on that sense of how to express that sense.
This is very understandable as a
excellent
process. Yes. I was
so
thinking, how do you apply fractals in particular?
Don't go there yet.
No, but that was
my
question.
That will be the next thing. Okay, well then. Fred, were you going to say something before?
Also, is the original problem the kind of a, this is not a pipe?
Yeah, there it is.
Yeah.
The pillow.
In the sense that, you can try and, this is just a representation of a wound, it's nothing. So for you, it was the importance of the work physically inhabiting this idea.
Well, I personally, if you don't mind me saying what we were talking about in your studio visits, I personally thought that the paintings weren't working. Forget about whether or not they were representing wounds or not wounds or whatever the story was. It just, they weren't alive somehow. They were, it's almost like they were missing something. Remember, we were having this long discussion, and we're both trying to figure out, I mean, they're well executed, the drawings are good, but they didn't pop. There's something that didn't go, it didn't have the wow factor, by which I don't mean that you're knocked over and think, yes, I wish I had 50,000 pounds to buy this. Something like that. Just putting a price tag on it. Anyway, it's rather that it wasn't generating that cohesion that needed to happen, that encounter that needed to happen. And that's when we started talking about the idea that the notion of vulnerability was being represented as a wound. You know, and then we started talking about the actual experience. You mind me talking about that?
Yeah, I don't have a problem.
Okay, can you talk about...
Yeah, it came out from... Actually, it was kind of the one... I realized that I had I knew I had a phobia against medical procedures. But then I realized
against
that...
Against medical procedures,
But then I realized that the base of that thing was being vulnerable. And when I knew that I had three events maybe in my life that created that, probably, which was when I had an accident and I was stitched on my head without anesthetics. When I was threatened with a knife to steal from me in the street. And maybe when I was in army. So from that moment, there are all kind of a different feeling of vulnerability, but there were all that sense of encounter. And the peculiar thing was that when I was in army, it was it had a duration, but I didn't realize it when I was in the army. Kind of, I still haven't figured out that. Yeah.
So the point is that the vulnerability, you weren't able to put it in words.
Yeah.
So that's part of it. There was no way to cognize that. So you kept trying to cognize it, but that kept making it stale or dead. That's the first thing. So we get back to the question of representation. Representation is, again, on one level, dealing with a fragmented associative moment that you can pull together and make into a unified whole. But what Banos was trying to play around with, or what you ended up doing, because remember when we drew the actual moment of your being assaulted, right, or that whole bit, and so, and how that actually looked on the street. I mean, what really went on with this? And that's when you started thinking, okay, there, that, what happened when that drawing?
I think that it was the different moments of encounter that was from the approach that they have from the establishment of the first relationship.
Where you thought someone was following you, that's the first thing, yeah.
And then the thinking of that something goes wrong, or it will end up wrong or worse. And the actual thing, and the after, what happens after, and it was at the beginning it was felt that it was one thing happened at the same time, the whole thing, and even 1 or 2 hours after that thing it was still the same, but then it starts to taking it apart and realizing that different feelings.
So those moments that you were taking apart, would it be fair, without trying to cramp it into a shoe that's too small, would it be fair to say that those moments could be understood as a fractal as opposed to fragments of what happened?
Based on pretty much the same sense.
Yeah, based on the sense that what you're trying to articulate isn't trying to piece together the whole, because there's no whole. Yeah, Fred.
Does that say that each moment of encounter is in its own fullness?
Yes. And it's kind of, the moments of encounter create ripples, roughness, create ripples of dimensionality and spatiality that begin to then create this sort of three-dimensional or four-dimensional moment of intensity. So the intensity is not made up of fragments of this happening, it's made up of these shards, these fractals that come in. So that's the first thing. Now that's the way in which one begins to connect with the logic of sense that brings you to trying to articulate this moment or these various moments. But now the next question, which is the question I thought you were asking, was slightly more practical in a certain sense, which is, how does that then connect with paint, literally? Like, how do you then take those energies that you're dealing with, that the kind of thing that Panos is talking about,
mm-hmm.
and thank you very much for sharing that, because they're very intense things, but, and then literally putting it on canvas. That's what I thought you were asking.
It was about fractals, how the fractals
did that make sense then?
Wall and painting.
Did that make sense then, what was just said?
In the process of doing something rather than visually, obviously.
Well, but it is also visual.
Okay.
But no, you can't agree unless you understand it.
I accept it.
No, you can't accept it. That's unfair and unfun. You have to, like, come into the... I'm not saying you have to be forced to accept it, but, I mean, it's important that you see what's at stake. because the resistance you're having is that what, you get tired, you're thinking, I'm tired, I want to make the last leap, it's just enough already, okay, good, move on, don't put the spotlight on me.
No, let's go on through.
Good, okay, so what that means is that you have this, if we go back to what Panos is saying about the three different moments of vulnerability that were, okay, Panos is, let's say, less than 70 and more than 10 years old, right? So you're some range. Anyway, whatever, however old you are. You have some range. So already in the span of life, there's many encounters that you've had, right? But for whatever reasons, three of them have some sort of resonate somehow. One is as a child getting your head stitched. One is this assault that happened, and the second is this kind of longer durational thing of just being flipped out about the army. And all the boys were expected to go into the army, too.
Yeah, it's mandatory for 2 years to go.
Is that true for the girls as well?
No, it's not in Cyprus. But they go to something that it's similar, that they attend one day. One day a week. One day
a week. It's hardly similar. One is 2 years, the other is a day.
It's completely different, but they have to do something.
They have to do something that means that they're part of the state. Anyway, so okay, you have three different encounters that have different durations. One, I'm not sure where it began. Again, you think of the slamming of the door. Where did the intensity begin? Was the intensity when the stitching of the head was actually happening, or when you fell and realized this is not good? You know.
I had a concussion, but...
So you didn't realize anything?
No, I remember the pain that was... That. Although I don't remember a lot of things, I remember the light and the pain.
And do you actually remember the stitching itself?
Yeah, the pain of the stitching.
Oh, not the pain of falling on the concrete stairs.
No, I didn't feel any pain. No, I don't remember.
So that was one set of encounters that get put together as one. So it's a multiple heterogeneic surface of encounters, of scenarios that manifest this one intensity. So the intensity is made up of this heterogeneic sense of these fractals coming in. And they create a cohesive moment of the one encounter. But in fact, the encounter literally isn't Fanos encountering the needle or something like that. It's not an encounter at that level. For me, it's an encounter of all these different encounters taken together that creates the moment that the encounter is realized. Mm-hmm. Does that make sense?
Yes.
Good. So that's much more than good, because that then is this kind of notion of how roughness is the terrain of the encounter. So you have all these different... So the encounter... So going back to, Heidegger, you have the encounter of A to A, and it's a very, I don't want to say straightforward. Oh, Heidegger's now a walk in the park, you know, it's very simple. No, but next to this, it is a lot simpler in that sense, in the sense that we're talking about this kind of dwelling that he's talking about. Whereas what Lyotard is doing, and Deleuze, and the way in which Panos is playing with it, is that the first thing, is that the first encounter, you wouldn't say the first encounter was when the needle went in the head, although that sort of focuses the mind. It was those different things that came together to create the encounter, encounter number one. Encounter number two was, it actually began when you thought you had moved to a new place and you thought this is a kind of rough area, and you thought this is a rough area and there's a possibility I might get assaulted and damn if you didn't, you know, right? So, and you had all this money on you and there's all this other stuff, and so there was many things created this entanglement of various scaredness that was going on that created another encounter. And that encounter started from walking outside with your rucksack down a path that you knew was going to be problematic, and thinking, with all the money you had in the world, basically, thinking, this would really be bad if I were robbed, and then you get robbed. So it's like... Right, so And that's the next encounter. Because even though the encounter turned out that the guy didn't find the actual full amount of money,
yeah.
right, didn't really matter in a certain sense because yeah. the encounter still ripped open a very specific wound, which we haven't even talked about. And not to, like psychoanalyze you and lay on the table here. But and then the next one was the army.
Yeah, it was before the assault.
Oh, I see, the army before, sorry. So, but the army, and the army is even a longer period, that's a 2-year period. So that moment of encounter durationally lasts 2 years. The other moment of encounter, I don't know, maybe lasted, you know, 4 hours if you include falling down the steps and getting stitched. Well, it was probably a very slow emergency room, so maybe it was 6 hours, but anyway, it's not two years. And the other encounter, the last encounter of the assault, lasted maybe 12 hours, something like that. So you have this different senses and different horrors that are going on that create this encounter. Fred?
I was just wondering, the kind of, the comment said that, can those same experiences in relationship to like a happiness?
What's his name?
In relationship to like happiness, because in this case we talk about trauma.
Well, vulnerability. Yeah.
Vulnerability and that kind of state.
Yeah.
Could the same be said for kind of experiences of happiness that they form? Or is
so,
it something...
So let me just say a couple things here. One is that it's not experience.
Mm-hmm.
So that's a banned word until we can deal with that.
Right.
Because it's an... Just use encounter for the time
yeah.
being. Mm-hmm. Which is why Lyotard has a whole thing on the assassination of experience by painting, because he's talking about encounter that gets established, and then that the experience is the recognizing of the encounter.
Yeah.
So that's why experience doesn't teach you anything, because you've already come with
okay.
a way to interpret it as a person. So just for the time being, ban it. But in terms of that, yes, why not? Happiness, boredom, whatever the various emotional charges are. You know, so it turns out that Panos is trying to think through this question of vulnerability, but maybe you're thinking through the question of happiness or irony or like boredom. Like, I think Molinier's work, for example, one of the papers I wrote many thousands of years ago, was that Molinier's work was a way to get rid of boredom. I mean, there's nothing to the work, and so in a certain sense that was tongue-in-cheek, but in another sense it was so wildly mad that it didn't, and yet it wasn't saying anything, and yet it said everything. And it kept doing this, and it was just a way that one played around with these concepts of boredom that normally settled onto the art world. You know, the kind of yawn, been there, know it all kind of scenario. So he was playing around with, he was really attacking the surrealist on these positions. So of course you can have totally, it doesn't have to be trauma. It doesn't have to be vulnerability. You know, it could be, you know, whatever other intensities, ecstatic moments exist. Lily? Okay. Yeah, Nick?
I was just saying, when you said ecstatic moments, it triggered off the thing. I would have thought sort of life is one long continuous encounter rather than sort of one or two or three. Or
maybe it's one long discontinuous encounter.
Yes. Yes, okay, yes, I take the point. But a series of encounters, probably lots and lots. That's
yeah,
what I'm trying to say,
and the
right?
series isn't in a row.
No.
The series can be, again, multidimensional.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, so that's, and when you start thinking like that, and yet if you really went like that, you'd probably go insane. You know, it'd be just too, you know, it's like,
too much.
It's just like, you know, just stay in bed, because there's just too many encounters.
Well,
you
is
know?
That why we're only conscious of the space on the mind of what actually happens to us?
Yeah. Conceivably,
otherwise
really.
We'd go
it just boof, you know,
yeah.
just like. However, the next question becomes, well, which are the ones that stick?
Mm.
Which are the ones don't stick?
And are we aware of them sticking?
Yeah.
Yeah. I guess that was my, like, the kind of the counterpoint. Happiness as an intensity, as some of these emotions, like, obviously the feeling of vulnerability can be something that's seemingly, I'm probably saying something wrong here, but far more impactful on yourself than a feeling of happiness. It's almost easier to forget.
Okay, so first of all, you're
really
Henry Miller. Sexist. S-E-X-U-S. Not sexist. And in that book, he has a great quote, which is that, you know, cry and the world cries with you, laugh and you laugh alone. He's like so sick of people crying all the time, you know, and like making positions about how traumatic their life is and so on. And he, I mean, I always loved that because I just thought, yes, this is fantastic. Because you just, at some point, actually being ecstatic, being joyful does have impact. It's just too exhausting to, you know, be pretty much the only one that's happy in the room. I mean, it's not that we're all should be happiness fairies, you know, like walk around going, you know, something sort of, you know, I mean, Anne Rand. Has everybody heard of this woman?
Yeah.
Fountainhead.
Yeah,
Fountainhead. Yeah.
The Fountainhead.
Yeah,
it's
Fountainhead,
really, really
Atlas Shrugged.
Yeah.
When I was like 13 or something, I read every single one of her novels.
About the same age, weirdly.
Yeah. Well, that is, it's a book for 13 years, I say this respectfully, but, you know, I mean, anyway, she's very right-wing, you know, go out, and her big line with Atlas Shrugged and all the rest of them was a smile is like the sign of an idiot, basically, you know, and then you have to, like, you know, true intelligence means that you're frowning all the time, which, you know, she obviously was English or something like that, but, you know, there is a view that if you're not suffering, if you're not in pain, then you're not a good artist, or you can't do art.
But that's really bullshit.
Of course it's bullshit.
Yeah.
I mean, because normally if you're in a lot of pain, you really can't do a whole lot, actually. It's pretty much, I mean, maybe you can rise above it and grab some of that pain and use it to work with, but you, generally speaking, it's a bit of a pain in the neck to be in pain. But of course, it's not that someone's in pain because they just feel like being in pain and they're just too lazy to be out of pain. That's not what it's about. Pain is a very specific thing. But one, also, I think what is underplayed a little bit is the role of ecstasy. I mean, not the drug, obviously. It's the, you know, the position of being, you know, actually even okay. But that, you know, okay, you don't have to be every 5 minutes, you know, this ecstatic person walking around, you know, and, you know, 25 orgasms later, you're just like, yes, I'm so happy. You know, no, I mean, you just, it's really that you're okay. And I think that you're okay with things. And the question is, how does that work? How do you get to that state, especially if your world isn't like that? You know, so it's just to say that whether or not one can figure out how to get there or not get there, that's one aspect. But you don't have to just focus on vulnerability in order to make it work. But focusing on vulnerability is one way to think this through, as long as it's not in this homogeneous slab called traumatic or trauma. And that's what you were beginning to figure out. Because when it was this homogeneous blob of trauma, it became very representational. And the work just didn't pop, as it were. But people have absolutely every right to do their work out of their pain. You know, like if it hurts, make it into art. You know, that you probably heard this expression, or if you haven't, there you go, there's the expression. Any other questions before we move on this? Okay, so we're covering a lot of ground. The next thing to think about now, okay, let's make sure that we're all more or less kind of coming along on this. First of all, thank you very much, Thanos, for explaining that. I think that that's not only brave, but also very intelligent the way you've done it. And I think that, do you think that your work has changed?
Yeah.
Oh, that's good. Man of many words.
And, I think it's in constant changing.
And just before we move off of your work, with the three different pieces, is there any one that you favor more than the other, or are they all just one big encounter?
That was the last one.
And
the
one that's on top.
Yeah, and I don't know, for some reason I still haven't grasped it, but it kind of feels like more close.
Yeah. Does it matter, would those pieces be on the wall, and therefore you wouldn't see the back of them?
Yeah, I don't know, because when I see the back of them, I didn't cut it. I kind of like it.
Yeah, definitely, don't cut it.
I don't know. I haven't yet figured it out.
A rotating stand.
Yes, right.
Rotating stands.
Yeah, it's just because that becomes another question. Okay, so how are we doing?
Okay.
Not ecstatic.
Okay.
Quiet.
I am happy to. We're pretty much at the end of where we're going to go, so we can, in fact, either continue on with this bit, or we can go over the essay questions one last time. Mm-hmm. Should we do the essay questions?
Yeah.
Okay. I still think that you should try an essay question.
I can try.
Okay, good.
But not so much.
Right, okay. How many people are now doing number one? One, two, three and a half, four. Okay, look around and see yourselves. There's Helen, there's Lily, there's Dorota, there's yourself, there's David, there's Amber. You guys work together on this.
I'm not sure if I want to do that one yet.
Okay. Or not. Okay. But I'm just saying that you shouldn't have to work in isolation. That doesn't mean that you produce one paper, but that you shouldn't. Okay, so David, can you read the question out loud?
Sure.
As our scribe, as our reader.
I seem to be elected. And we have been immersed in three different types of surfaces. Number one, the libidinal band. Two, an ephemeral skin. Three, a plane of immanence. Are these all the same kinds of surfaces? And if not, how do they differ? In what way or ways does emotion, sexuality, fluxus, and flow come to A, brackets, the surface? Bonus, what is radical difference?
Okay, so now you were going to answer this by relying on Stenger's.
I had a few ideas about it, yeah.
Can you say them out loud?
Yeah, sure. well, I really like Deleuze. So, Plane of Immanence was really cool, and me and my friend was discussing this. So, for me, I'm going to begin with the Plane of Immanence, even though it's three, and work through the ephemeral skin and the normal band. But the reason I was interested in bringing Evel Stenger's in it was because if any of you have ever seen, looked at Alfred North White's Process and Reality, it's a huge book, I've never read all of it, but I've got the thing and I occasionally turn
dip
a few pages.
Yeah,
yeah.
Right.
It puts
Alfred Whitehead.
Alfred North Whitehead, yeah. Bit of a backstory, he's a mathematician. He incredibly got to his position teaching philosophy. While there's a very famous quote of him saying, I didn't even try and be a philosopher. Because he was trying to understand the relationship between mathematics and metaphysics. And what he discovered, as Stenger says, is that he encounters issues in doing so. But importantly, he seems to... I think of this as... if you look at something... and you see the way it's interpreted. If all of you looked at Evel Stenger's and looked at Alfred North White's superject, does that word mean anything? Okay. Basically...
You don't go too deep into what you're doing, just
okay.
Basically.
Basically, I'm interested because I think that each surface discusses the way something is resolved differently.
Okay.
And, or lack of being resolved. And how each one has a sense about it,
mm-hmm.
And has each one pertain to its own logic is interesting, especially when you put in the bonus.
And what does radical difference mean to you here?
Well, since it's the Deleuze's, and you mentioned it earlier, I think I'm cheating a bit, to be honest.
It doesn't matter. You can't cheat on these questions.
No, well, radical difference, I've yet to answer this in a sense, I'm probably wrong, but radical difference is... the process by which something is understood as being, it's not just it, well yeah it is, it's having its own sense, and in that sense not relying, or at least not not being part of the relation. I can't put it into words.
I can say it, yes. Just leave it there, because it'll be said. Amber, did you want to like say how you were going to answer that?
I think the various kind of surfaces and kind of... I think I'd go through basically the kind of progression we've gone through tonight, ending up with the idea of the topologies into expanding or folding up into dimensions, in terms of how that would, how that is in layout.
Perfect. Yeah, I was going to say, can you connect it to your work?
Because there's lots of surfaces and sort of palimpsests and various dimensionalities which aren't there, or which could be there in time, or things like that. So I think.
And can you answer what radical difference might mean?
If difference in the Heideggerian sense is something which nonetheless implies that we're differing from something, therefore there is something to differ from, and that you're, and that whatever is different in terms of what's different from, then if radical difference would mean that you weren't differing from
good
anything which you weren't
good
self-generating.
There were no poles to the there's no endpoints to the difference. Good. Who else was doing one? Yeah, I can see the other two of you have been very quiet. No, I'm not doing one anymore. Georgia, were you gonna do one?
I don't know yet.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, I just
do you have any ideas on, okay, number two?
No, I've got a plan how I'm going to do this.
Okay, how do you plan to do one?
The plan is I look how much time do I have.
Okay.
My God.
Yes.
So I just look at the time first.
And then breathe. Okay, number two.
Thinking via the skin, the varying techna / technologies of cohesion / entanglement / movement / imagination through / with / alongside / without the senses. How does radical vandalism come into the picture? Emma Shamali, that's in brackets.
That's the artist that does vandalism.
Bonus. Link this problem to the Heideggerian event of appropriation and show how it involves temporality, dimension, and colour.
Now, the person who is best placed to answer this question is Julie. And can you see why from your image that you were playing with?
When I read the last sentence, yes. For dimension and colour.
Can you show them the image that you showed me?
Sure.
And tell them a little backstory about that.
So my work has changed an awful lot. It's rapidly changing. I was watching The Night Porter, and as luck would have it, serendipitously, the screen froze. And maybe 6 months ago, I would not have grabbed my iPad and ran and taken a photograph of it. But I really liked the image that was created. So, and you've got that, we were talking about who knows how to hide,
mm-hmm.
knows how to love. There is a hidden image behind the lines of the couple in mm-hmm. the embrace in the story. And that speaks to me in so many ways.
Where's the couple that's in the embrace is, of course, the couple that was dealing with the whole Nazi scenario, and so you need to include that, because all the different layers, and as Emmerich mentioned the word palimpsestuous, all the different ways in which these time dimensions kind of flow in and flow out. And then you also have the colors coming down as this rain cloud, this electrical rain cloud.
And there was something, I wish I'd almost taken a video as well, because there was some pulsing going on the screen, which was fantastic. So I'm going to have to try and devise a way to make the artwork, which I'm going to make from this, pulse.
Great.
In the sense that you can have, like the Bridget Riley idea of
oh, very exciting.
Pieces that just start to play with each other on the surface. There might not be surfaces, there might be all sorts of dimensions going on.
Fabulous. Anybody else going to do two that wants to admit it? Okay, no? Okay, three.
Sure. Lyotard speaks of intensities, and with it, the tensor band. Heidegger poses the problem in terms of poetics, and techna, and dwelling. Benjamin rephrases along the lines of translation, the moment of material reality, and the ability, therefore, for a work of art to have an aura and to speak. Explore what is meant in these different approaches to materiality and the ability for art to communicate. Bonus. Connect this with Foucault/Deleuze's notion of deterritorialization.
So after you finish fainting from this question, what do you think is being asked? Is anybody going to answer this question?
I was thinking about it a little bit.
How would you kind of play with this? This is an epistemology question, basically. This is asking you, how does the logic work?
Well, it's looking at how, or one could look at, in answering it, could look at how each of the people mentioned deals with the question we've been speaking about this evening, which we keep coming back to, what is it that makes it work? And then, well, finding a way, obviously, because the various philosophers do relate to each other and kind of destroy each other's arguments, looking at what comes out, I guess relating it back to my own work, where I find what kind of resonates, what description of it, or which definition resonates with my
excellent
work.
Perfect. Excellent. Excellent.
Four. Barad speaks of transmaterialities and the question of queer feminism by relying in particular on two concepts, diffraction and entanglement. Discuss in relation to A, a body without organs, and B, the logic or logics of sense/sensualities, erotic praxis. Bonus. What does Einstein's concept of general relativity have to do with this?
Who wants to attack this one? Fred?
We have not yet looked at Einstein.
That is true. Good point. What do you think Einstein's relativity? Well, this is obviously you don't have Einstein's relativity in 30 seconds or less, for speed dating or something, speed quantum physics. But basically, the takeaway from that is that if you think of the equation E equals mc squared, the equal sign in the Heideggerian move has two endpoints, both A's, A equals A. But in the, and Heidegger can't get rid of those endpoints. It becomes important for him to keep those there in order for the difference, as Amber was pointing out, can establish itself. But in the Einstein move, the only reason E and mc squared are there is because they're attracted to each other. So there are no endpoints. So one has the endpoint endgame, and the other one doesn't. And so the periphery of the whole statement of the E equals mc squared doesn't require observers or positionalities outside the system. It happens whether or not you're standing there or observing. So that's the main point. I mean, obviously, those people that haven't become obsessed with Einstein will not want to do this question. So once I get you to agree to do the question, you don't have to do the Einstein section of it. But, don't forget, you can have half of this essay be your artwork. It's very important, especially your artwork, which is now so shifted from the representational work that you were doing to this kind of really very alive, expressions of encounter.
And back.
What's that?
And it's already back into representational.
Is it already back in it? What happened?
I'm changing very fast.
I see that.
This.
Okay. Right. Yes.
On the point of semantics, or probably pedantics.
Pedantics.
Is it equal mc squared general or special relativity?
General.
So general, is it? Right.
But remember that general came... No, sorry, it's special relativity.
I think it's special.
Yeah, special, sorry.
Because the general relativity questions
are crazy. Yeah, sorry. It's the other way wrong. Did you have a comment on that? No. Okay. Last question.
Indeed.
That was great.
Can a machine think, in inverted commas, by the way, create, be an artist, know that it likes ice cream with a cherry on top, have itchy skin, discuss in relation to Turing and Mandelbrot, morphogenesis / fractals, and the work of artist Philip Beasley? Bonus. How does discursive methodologies, especially the concept of becoming X, connect to this problem of invented life?
It's a creepy question.
Yeah.
Anybody going to try to do artificial intelligence?
I think it'd be a very dark hole you'd be going into.
Yeah. There was something that just came on the news the other day where they mentioned something about machines now being, well, you know, with the whole Go thing that's going on.
There was just one.
Man
was just one, a match.
A match, right.
A
but,
match
but all right, you know, that's okay.
But it's Chinese chess-like match.
Yeah. I mean, what's interesting is kind of reminds me of the story with the horse, you know, the horse eventually outruns the locomotive, but, you know.
Oh. Hawking thinks that's how it's all going to end.
That's
it?
Right.
Yeah.
You know, the upbeat Hawking.
Yeah.
Okay, I want you to have a wonderful holiday. If you get stuck at all, make sure to email Dane or Mattia, lastly myself. No, seriously, if you get stuck, email.